my relationship with URI goes back a long ways to 1970, when I left the U.S. Navy and on the GI Bill went to the Graduate School of Oceanography to get my doctorate in geological oceanography. And so it's been a long time, 40 years plus. There was a huge revolution in our sciences with the avocation of plate tectonics, which completely turned the geosciences upside down. So clearly the direction of research has changed dramatically. I've also always had a passion for the technology of exploration. And when I look back at what I was using in 1970 for my thesis work in the Gulf of Maine and compare it to what I have right now, it's like two cans and a string. The technology is just in full acceleration. What I like about GSO is they don't have departments. You know, they don't artificially bust us up into the physicists and the chemists and the mathematicians and the geologists or the geophysicists, the biologists. We're all one, literally one big happy family. We meet as a group. So we're running counter to how many other oceanographic institutions run themselves by busting themselves up and saying, oh, I know someone at that university. And they say, well, no, he's in the other department. I never deal with that department. At GSO, we're always meeting as one group. And I think the excitement of exploration, the excitement of research is always on the edge of a discipline, but it's really exciting when two edges touch. And so you're constantly having this blending of the sciences, and new ideas come out of that, big new ideas come out of that. It's really right at the beginning of a revolution in how oceanography is done. We're playing a leadership role in the development of telepresence with the building of the new Center for Ocean Research and Ocean Exploration and the new Inner Space Center. We are actually right in the cutting edge of deep sea exploration using this new telepresence technology. So I expect that to continually change the way we do business. When I started my explorations and I was doing my doctoral thesis at URI, I used a submarine at Woods Hole called Alvin. And I would literally go to work in a submarine. I'd get in the submarine, go down to work. And as I went deeper and deeper into the ocean, I realized I was spending most of my time commuting and spending very little time exploring. And so it was in 1981, I published a cartoon in National Geographic magazine that said, someday we will not go physically. We will send our spirit. We will literally have an out-of-body experience. And using advanced telecommunications, using advanced fiber optic technology, robotics, we can now literally conduct our explorations from anywhere you want to conduct it. You can do it on your iPhone, your iPad, on your computer, or one of these more sophisticated command centers, and not actually have to go out to sea, because it's quite, you know, you spend so much time waiting around for things to happen. Now we are really implementing a technology of beaming us down to the bottom of the ocean when we're needed. And that is just in its infancy. And Rhode Island and the Graduate School is playing a leadership role in this new paradigm of exploration. When you look at the fact that 72% of our planet is covered by the oceans, and it's very deep, the average depth of the ocean is 12,000 feet. So most of our planet, in fact, half of the United States of America lies beneath the sea in remote parts of the planet and have never been explored. So it's all about getting bottom time. And the old way of physically going down there, you didn't get much bottom time. You went down, looked around, spent maybe 3 hours, just a couple of you looking out of a window, and then up you had to come to recharge your batteries to do it the next day. Now, put it down, leave it down. So our rate of exploration is increased by an order of magnitude. We can now explore 24 hours a day instead of 2.5 hours a day. And we can also have the entire world participate in the exploration. So we have not just one mine down there, have as many mines as you want. So with that acceleration of bottom time, you should see acceleration of discoveries. And so I'm expecting lots of new discoveries. I think people think the Earth is explored, and we're now going to turn our attention to the heavens to explore outer space. We have better maps of Mars than we have of our own planet. So I see our planet being explored more. I see the next generation of kids that we're trying to reach with our live programming. I see the next generation of kids that are in middle school are going to explore more of Earth than all previous generations combined. So exploration is not something in our history books, it's in our future. Michael Brennan is one of my great graduate students, along with Katie Croft. Michael Brennan, actually, I first met him when he was 12 years old. We were doing the Jason Project broadcast in Norwalk, Connecticut. And Mike came up to me as a little kid and said, I want to be an Argonaut. And those are the kids that we actually take on our expeditions. And then a few years later, because he had to get to be 15, so it was 3 years later, we were doing a project in Yellowstone Park on the great volcano there and the hydrothermal vents. And Mike came on that expedition and he said, now what do I do? And I said, well, go off and get a really good education. So he went off to Bowdoin and got a dual degree or dual major in geology and archaeology. I got another letter years later, says, okay, I'm ready now. And he applied. I think he's been with me almost 5 years now and he's about to defend, and I'm so proud. I feel like a very proud parent. It's really interesting. People know me best for finding the Titanic and the Bismarck and PT-109 on these ancient shipwrecks as well. That's very recent in my career. I'm an explorer. And what I have found was the most important discoveries were not the Titanic. I mean, we knew it existed. But the discovery of hydrothermal vents in 1977, new life forms, the discovery of black smokers and tremendous mineral deposits, all of those discoveries we didn't know existed. They were discovered by accident, looking for one thing, finding something else. So if you then say, wait a minute, you mean most of your important discoveries were done by accident? Yes. And we've only explored maybe 1%? Yes. What do you think's the other 99 got? I don't know, but I'll bet on it. You know, how can I tell you what I'm going to discover? I haven't discovered it yet. But I'll bet statistically that if I can make the discoveries I've made so far by looking at so little, just imagine what's out there. Well, I'm imagining there's a lot out there that's really going to reshape our ability to live on this planet. We're going to find new resources. We're going to find new insight. We just need to get out there and look.